Hello, good morning, welcome back to the fish locker out on the shore. Now it's a gorgeous morning, isn't it? I don't know if you can see that sunrise behind me. It is shaping up to be a fantastic day, a balmy October morning. I don't know if you've noticed, but I have got my woolly coat on today. 7 degrees when I got out of the van this morning, so not quite as warm as what we've been used to, but it is just stunning, isn't it? See this little area where I'm at here now? Just gorgeous, isn't it? Now I am gonna follow the coastal path around that way like that. You might notice. I'll address the elephant in the room. I have hurt my finger. I'm gonna follow the coastal path around that way, possibly to that point, and then we're gonna work our way back as the tide ebbs off along the shore. And if it stays calm like this, we will try and get the suit out later on and we'll see what we can find in the water. Fingers crossed. Like I say, it is getting colder now. We'll play it by ear. But yeah, I'm excited just to be out. It's gorgeous this morning. The area where I'm walking about today is a spot of coast near Prussia Cove. Like Russia, but with a P in front of it, Prussia. And I don't know if you can see, but it really is just, this is the type of architecture that I just think is fantastic. I mean, look at that door there. They just don't make stuff like that anymore, do they? Shame. Or even stuff like these walls here. Bah, those jackdaws up there are making a hell of a racket, aren't they? The area that we're coming down to, down here, I'll just try and show you through these trees. We're going to follow the coast path along there. No, we're following the coast path along. They are having a chatter this morning, aren't they? There's going to be a buzzard or so much up there. We're going to follow the coast path along. And then as the tide ebbs off, we'll head back up and see about getting the wetsuit. Because I've had a quick look with the drone. I'll hopefully have had some decent drone footage to put in before here. Bad luck with the drone, and the water clarity does look good. And I have been to an area round here before, and it is nice shoreline. So we'll have a look. I do love getting out at this time of morning. I quite enjoy it. When it's fresh, like when you're breathing through your nose and it kind of stings your nose and your throat. Yeah, we're definitely coming into winter. Well, I suppose we're in autumn now, but it feels like winter. Been spoilt with a soft summer, I think. You see here, we've got some honeysuckle berries. Got some bryony. Mentioned that in another video. Both white bryony and black bryony. You can see some more of the berries up there. white briny and black briny, all of the berries are toxic. So you don't want to be snaffling them. These are ivy. See where they're coming to fruit. You'll often find wood pigeons gorging themselves on these. There's some more briny. So even though they look nice, don't eat them, because you will regret it. And there, some sloberries. It is a lovely time of year for the fruits. Here's a nice little burst of colour, a little bit of gorse. Everything else is dying off, all the flowers are gone, well gone. High road or low road? Stick to the beach. Change again. The type of place you'd expect to see like a bearded tit or a bittern. Yeah, the briny that we keep seeing, the white and the black, it's there, look, there is a prime example. See all the berries? The easiest way to decipher between black or white, why you would want to, I'm not entirely sure, because they're both toxic. Easiest way to decipher the two is when they've got leaves, because one's got like a five-lobed leaf and one's got a heart-shaped leaf. When you're in a stage like this where none of them have got leaves, white briny has tendrils. It's a twiny, it's like a twiny creeper that wraps around other plants as it climbs up. And if I can find one now, I'll show you. But yeah, if it has tendrils that wrap around, like little tiny grappling strips, it's white. If it doesn't, it's black. I am looking for a way of trying to get down there onto the beach. Because as I've explained in other shore foraging videos, you get a good idea of what's out there by what you find on the high tide line. So by having a look on the shoreline, if I can find any shells, cockles, clams, razor clams, that type of shells, then that is a good indication that that is what there will be living in the area. Right, this here, this might not be to everyone's tastes, but I find it quite interesting. What we have here is we have some scat. It's poop, and I think it's fox poop. And the reason you can tell is when you look at it, if you can see, it's full of fur. And there, look, if you can see in this one, it's full of little tiny bones. So little vertebrae from like a field mouse or a shrew or something. Now you can find pellets that come from owls. Pellets that come from owls, but you usually find those near a perch. And what they do is when they've eaten a mouse or something and they can't digest all the bones and the fur, is they cough it up. Well, animals like foxes and badgers, they can. So they just pass it all the way through. This here, this is a lovely little, see that little yellow one there? That's a snapdragon. I'm amazed to see it actually, because it's getting cold now, it's getting autumn. Yeah, the foxes generally find somewhere like a mound, like a high point, like even like this here. They like to broadcast their presence. So he'll be marking his territory by putting his calling card, shall I say, on an area like that. Badgers are slightly different. Inside of a badger's territory, they have a midden. They have an area which is like where they always go to the bathroom. You'll find it sometimes when you're walking through a wood, because you'll find a load of holes, only shallow ones, maybe about 6 inches deep, just absolutely filled with poop. And what they do is they keep going back to the same place. So yeah, there is a couple of little facts about poop. This little bit here, I'm going to be quite careful to... This is rock samphire, and this interesting one there and there that you can see. You see the triangular cross section? You can tell them they're like a succulent green. They've got a really interesting name. They're called either a pig face or a hottentot fig. Hottentot fig. Now I found some of those in a previous video, another area of coast, and quite a few people from across the globe got in touch with me. Apparently they're quite common in South Africa and over in the States. But yeah, a pig face or a hottentot fig. Anyway, this here is a little man-made cut down to the beach, so I'm going to take full advantage of it. This always fascinates me. You see there how inside this shale there are like injection seams of like a quartz. I've always found that fascinating. There's another one, look, guys. See how the full seam has kind of worked its way up through there. There's a friend of mine who's a geologist. He's been in a few of the videos, Tom. And I was asking him about it. I always find it really interesting. It comes from, obviously, the difference between like sedimentary metamorphic rocks. And what happens is the pressure underneath the cement, the sedimentary, fractures it, and the very, very top, oh, there is a monster seal. Don't know if you can see it, just at the end of that. Yeah, that is a big seal. It builds up pressure underneath the sedimentary rock, and then fractures it. And the bit that slips up through the fracture is usually like the top of what sits on top of the molten. So like fractional distillation, when you're dealing with like separating off crude oil into things like bitumen and tar, then diesel, then petrol, then like your LPG right at the very top. Your deposits of like your precious metals, your minerals and things like that, they're what sits right at the top. So that's why you get like a seam of gold, or like a seam of ore. I find it fascinating. And you can see them all there, look. See, as the seams have kind of... So it's been built up underneath, and when it's fractured it, it's seeped into the seam. And when you come to things like granite rocks, if you notice that in some of them that the size of the crystals are bigger than others, and it's to do with the speed in which they cool. If they cool slowly, then you have bigger crystals. If they cool quickly, then you have smaller crystals. I've really enjoyed learning about it. I find it fascinating. Even when I was at school. Now look. So rocks like this. There's a nice one. I don't really approve of taking too many rocks from the shore, but I like that one. It's almost the, like the size of a quartz geode, isn't it? Look. Yeah, I'll put that one in my bag. Don't tell anyone. That there is a bullhus egg. That's the egg casing from a bullhus. Tell it's a bullhus by the size. Now you do, some sharks and rays, they do lay eggs. Dogfish lay eggs like this, but they're like a third of the size. Rays lay purses like this, but they're usually flatter. Yeah. Just gonna have a little quick look up in here to see what's washed up in here. That there is from a commercial trawl. Call them like a rockhopper disc. They're usually made out of cuts of car tyre. What they do is they run along like a tickler chain. If you're fishing in sand for flatfish, you can use small ones. If you're fishing in rocks, like in hard ground for codlings, these are like demersal trawls, ones that trawl along the bottom. If you're fishing for things like codling in rocks, you'll have big uns, big rockhoppers, and they're like a buffer, like a sacrificial piece that bumps along the bottom so you don't tear through your net or your chain or your warps. Right, let's see if we can make our way up here. And if by magic, there we go. I will say there is a safety warning here, is it? I know that the tide's going out for another 2 hours. You need to know what the tide's doing when you're coming and doing things like this. Because if you've got yourself in an area like that cave there, with the tide coming in, and you couldn't climb out like I did, you'd be trapped in there and the tide would come in and trap you. I knew that even if I couldn't climb up that rock just there and then, if I waited for half an hour, the tide would go further down and I could walk around. If you are coming, this is kind of where I tell you not to do what I do. If you are coming down rock hopping like this, the proper footwear is very important. And although you will see me wearing Wellington boots, because I like them because I can wade in the water, and I like them because they don't get me muddy, a strong pair of like ankle supporting walking boots are good for this. Or something, sometimes you can get shoes and wellies with studs in the bottom for extra grip. Just be safe, common sense. This here, you know, like I was saying about how owls spit up a pellet. Well, seagulls do as well. Seagulls don't eat the same things that owls eat. So generally, like you're finding here, these ones have been in the fields. They've just been eating anything, well, you know, seagulls, probably fish and chips. They've been eating anything they can find. But most of those are husks from like corn or wheat that they found in the fields. Seagulls are, well, absolute opportunists. I've seen them eating roadkill. I've seen them eating live chicks, like other seabirds. You see them on cliff, especially blackbacks. Blackbacks are just vicious. They'll wait until a parent bird gets up off a nest, fly down and eat an entire seagull chick. Eat baby rabbits, eat a lot. And they aren't. Although their digestive system is strong for digesting things like fish bones, they will cough up stuff, regurgitate bits that they can't digest. Right, I've had a lovely walk along the beach. First person to walk on the beach today. Sand was absolutely pristine. This is bladder rock, and this is actually called lava. It is edible. They do make lava bread out of it. It's a really long and convoluted recipe of boiling it for hours and yeah. This, however, sea lettuce, it's much more easily edible. What I'm going to do is I am going to billy goat my way across these rocks. Across these rocks and back up there, around the back. And we will be just in time to go and get the suit on. Just making my way back up now. I don't know if you can see down there or here. James absolutely loves these, loves tree tunnels. Just flying overhead there was a pair of ravens. Now, for anybody who doesn't know what a raven is, imagine a really, really big crow, jet black, and it's got like a big thick beak that's got a hook on the end. Like a crow's beak, it's just like that, and a rook's beak is quite long and it's pale. Jackdaws are small, ravens are massive. This is exactly what I was talking about badgers. See how it's dug a little hole and it goes in the same place all the way along the bottom of this bush. All these little holes here all filled with it. That's a badger. Depending on which way you want to look at it, they're quite tidy, aren't they? They always go in the same place. But yeah, they usually, from their diet, full of all sorts. They eat pretty much anything they can get their hands on. Berries, beetles, worms, even roots, cereal crops, everything. Even like small rabbits, if you can get them. So yeah, foxes are usually a one-off, like on a mound, because it likes to broadcast its presence. And a badger has like a little spot where it digs a load of holes. Right, well, I've got down here, I've got all my gear. The wind is picking up a little bit, but hopefully it won't cause us too much trouble. I'm gonna try something new. One, two. Let's go and get wet. That was fresh. Immediately you can see the terrain is full of rocky crevices and kelp with lots of vivid red dulse. I do really like these green snake locks and anemones. Under this crevice was a very shy little lobster. He was a little too fast for the camera, sadly. Looking along the ledges, I found a lot of ballonrass hiding away. And some great edible crabs. Lots of big prawns on this dive as well. I can see you hiding there, you know. These bloody Henry starfish have such wonderful vivid colours. For anyone wondering, these guys are not easy to get out. Another bloody Henry doing his thing. And another. There is just such variety of life down here. So many weeds and corals and anemones and creatures. I just love it. A couple of two-spotted gobies. And in these cracks and rocks, there was an awful lot of squat lobsters. Just a little too small and camouflaged to show on the camera properly. Now these to me looked like anchovies. An aggressive looking velvet swimming crab. A little leopard spotted goby at the back of his hole. And a couple of spiny starfish. I like these little tunnels. And back through we go. Simply stunning. For anyone who hasn't seen our nighttime foraging sessions, I'd have a look because these guys steal the show. Oh, hello in there, Mr. Conger. Rough ground eels are often really dark and they love these little caves, so beware where you put your fingers. Jackpot! Now that is what I was looking for. Perfect eating size lobster, and what a beauty this was. These tiny little guys are blue-rayed limpets. And a late season spider crab to finish off with. See you later.
Right, I'm out of the water now. I really reached my limit. I got to the point where my hands were that cold, I just didn't have the dexterity to do anything. I barely had the dexterity in my fingers to turn the GoPro on and off. So, this fantastic lobster could not have come at a better time.
Nope, where are you going? Stay there, you.
Yeah,
Fantastic dive. Spider crabs, edible crabs, velvet swimming crabs, wrasse, four or five different species of wrasse, a load of gobies, two massive great conger eels. I hope those have shown up all right. Did see one bass, but it was too far off. Loads of shoals of mackerel and pilchards. There was absolutely loads to see. Some fantastic anemones and some stunning starfish as well. Loads of those bright, like pink and purple and neon orange bloody Henrys. So that was incredible. Yeah, I'm gonna wrap up real quick because I am cold. I'm gonna get me gear on, get back to the van, because it's gonna be time to pick James up. And then once we pick James up, me and him might go out and we'll have a little cook up. If not, we'll take it out tomorrow and we'll cook it up. That's more like it. Just starting to get feeling back in my fingers. Pushed myself a little bit past my limit there. It's end of October. I'm in a 5mm suit without gloves on. Just got too cold for my hands. Luckily, I found that lobster when I still had a little bit of movement in my fingers. Otherwise, I'd have been wounded. I love this. I take it out on a boat with me. I got our last one as well. I made this up at, what time did I leave the house? 5:15. So I made this up about 5 o'clock. What time is it now? 2:20. So 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 1, 2. So we're talking, what? Between 8 and 9 hours. Actually, it's still probably a bit too hot to drink. I'll show you there, look. Shows you how hot it is. Look at the steam coming out of it. Yeah, they're fantastic then. Look, I'm on a boat. But I'm going to sit down now and I'm going to enjoy a Kit Kat and a drink of hot Ribena. And then when I've warmed up, I'm going to go out and get James. Right, James and I have come down onto the beach. We have the lobster that I caught earlier on when I was diving, and you'll probably see behind us, I am just getting the Swedish torch going. Now this is a cross between a Swedish torch and a rocket stove. I've got a video on the Fish Locker Workshop channel showing how I make these, but these are perfect for this type of beach cook-up. All I'm doing is I'm getting the fire going inside of it, so as you can see, it's properly going inside of there now. All I've done is, these are my offcuts and my pieces of pallet wood, and I just break them down into little tiny slivers and just feed the fire with them like that until it properly starts burning. Actually that one can go inside. Properly starts burning. I'm going to go and get a pan full of clean seawater and then we're going to cook the lobster. What I've been doing is I've been getting a little slivers of pallet wood, just taking my Leatherman, and all I'll do is start a little area in, a couple of bats like that, and you just make the slivers smaller and smaller. Whoa. Now look. Just like that. That's how simple it is. What we're doing while we're waiting for the water to boil is, what we're looking for?
Treasure.
We're treasure hunting. So far we have found lots of treasure. Are you going to tell people what we've found?
Glass, stones,
sea glass and shells and, oh, you dropped one. Yeah, look. So we're collecting sea glass. James likes sea glass. And pretty shells. So there you go. You're going to put them in your pockets, are you? Right. There you go. And what are you going to do with all your treasure?
Buy things a bit.
I'm not sure that the toy shop takes sea treasure, but we'll see. Cooking lobsters and crabs
so simple. It really is. All you need to do is, I use clean seawater. If you can't get clean seawater, fresh water with salt added. Bring it to the full rolling boil, and that's, you see how that's boiling in there? Like a fierce rolling boil. Then put the lobster in. Then when it comes back up to the rolling boil, give it 2 more minutes and then it's ready to come off. So this here, that lobster there, you can see that rolling boil, that's been at that for a couple of minutes now. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to take it off, drain the water, and we're going to get eating. But you can see here how the torch is burnt down. It almost looks like a Halloween lantern, doesn't it? But yeah, the air goes in there and feeds the fire inside the log. But yeah, that's been 2 minutes at the rolling boil and it's ready to come off. Wow. Right then, best boy. Yeah. We've got our lobster and we have now got our melted butter. Yeah. Whoa, look at that. That is what we like, isn't it? Ooh, I think I might get a photo. Right, all I've done is I've got a little glass dish and in the water I've just melted a little bit of butter. So claws
and legs.
Yeah, if you just let him sit there next to you, give him a little bit of one of these. In fact, where's my picking stick?
That's glass.
It's not, it's a stick, James. It's, I've just carved this out of a piece of look at that. That is a lovely piece of lobster meat.
Here's a pirate,
SpongeBob lobster pants.
SpongeBob SquarePants.
Are you ready, kids?
Aye, aye, Captain.
I can't hear you. Oh!
Everything about undersea SpongeBob SquarePants. SpongeBob SquarePants. I'm doing it crack gun style.
You're gonna crack them, are you?
Yeah.
Which one do you want to crack? Yeah. You want to try a little bit of this?
No, thank you.
Okay. You happy with what you got?
Mm-hmm.
Can I have one of your crackers?
Okay.
Thank you very much. There you go. Lobster on a cracker.
Banana tree.
I've explained this in other videos as well. The easiest way to get the tail out, I've found, you get hold of the tail section like that, the flaps, a couple of sideward motions pulls the back off sideways like that, and then just like that. Now open the back out, take out the intestine line, and the rest is good to eat. You want to try some?
We're actually going to have to make tracks because the tide's coming in. Come on then, if you want to do some cracking, do it now. Because we've got to put all these in a rock pool in a minute.
Aye, aye, sir.
Right. That's us finished. Like I say, we're going to have to wrap up now because the tide's coming in and we're going to get stuck. I hope you've enjoyed joining me out for a dive. I had a fantastic dive in a new area that I haven't dived before.
The midnight zone?
The midnight zone for vampire squid?
Yeah.
I hope the footage has turned out all right. I would definitely like to go back there again, but probably going to be next year now because it's getting very, very cold. I was blue when I got out of the water. If you like this type of video, let me know. Please subscribe to the channel and tick the notification bell for all notifications. That way you don't miss when our next video comes out. All the best, and what do we say?
Bye from the fish locker. Beach.
Bye from the fish locker.
Beach.
Beach.